Jens Kosiol and Gabriele Tänzer. Jens will be presenting the paper at the University of Marburg on a generalized concurrent rule construction for double pushout rewriting. We are looking forward to your presentation also, Jens. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the introduction, Lane. Generalized concurrent rule construction. So what's our motivation? If we simplify a little bit what's happening in the concurrent rule construction, we have the concurrent rule construction allows for the sequential composition of rules, and it takes into account transient elements. So a concurrent rule identifies elements that are created by the first rule and deleted by the second, and these transient elements created, directly deleted, they don't turn up these two rules. And what we are interested in is to be able to deal with another kind of elements, namely, we want to be additionally able to identify with elements of the same type in the right place, which are created by the second, so that you are able in a generalized concurrent rule to not delete and recreate the same element, but to say, okay, that's, we can regard this as the same element, we can preserve it. So we aim at this kind of directed preservation of information. Why are we interested in this kind of thing? So let me give you a quick example. It stems from refactoring of class diagrams one, and you see it as a graph transformation rule in it, and the class redirects a reference to the third class, which then does all the work. And if the second class doesn't do anything else, we might as well replace it with a direct reference from the first class to the third.
Another typical
refactoring is the extraction of subclasses. So we have class four and
the sound is not so good. The sound is not so good. So
do
maybe you
hear
can...
me?
Yes, but it's not so good. So maybe you can switch off the camera. Then we might hear you better.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Does it work better now?
Yes, I think so.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry.
Sorry.
Yeah. Thank you for noticing and remarking it.
Continue. Yeah, we still have some time in the lunch break. We can do that then.
Yeah, the second example is just the extraction of subclasses. So we, to the class four, we add a new subclass here, the class with number six. And the rule takes care of that it's not unnecessary. So we only want to extract the subclass if it really should do some work. So we redirect a reference, which pointed to the original class, to this newly extracted subclass. And if we compute a concurrent rule from these two rules, where we identify the class one with the class five and the class three with the class four, we obtain this rule. The reference created by remove middleman is directly deleted by extract subclass, so it's a transient element. It does not occur in the concurrent rule. And we just delete the class with two and create a subclass of this class four. But if we are given one example, this graph G, where we have clients, employees, persons, and we now want to make employees a subclass of the class person, we cannot apply this concurrent rule, because in the double pushout approach, you can only delete nodes which have no adjacent edges, which are not deleted by the rule. So we cannot delete and recreate employee, because it already references this company class. So if we want to make employee a subclass of the person class, we need to have something else. And our generalized concurrent rules are intended to be able to do exactly something like that. So this is an example for a generalized concurrent rule derived from the concurrent rule. And we allow identifying the class two and its incoming reference, which is deleted by remove middleman, with the class six and its incoming reference, which are created by extract subclass, and say instead of deleting and recreating, we want to directly preserve this. And then we obtain the, again, typical refactoring that replaces delegation with inheritance. And this rule is applicable because it does not lead the employee class any longer. Okay, in this talk, we want to introduce these generalized concurrent rules as an extension of the concurrent rule construction, which allows for the kind of directed preservation, which I just talked about. We want to locate this generalized concurrent rule construction among the already existing kinds of rule composition. We want to check that our construction indeed formalizes the intuition, which I just illustrated, and present a generalized concurrency theorem for our new construction. Our setting are emmetive categories and some minor further technical assumptions. So we need emmetive unions and factorizations of pairs of morphisms. Our input are linear rules with arbitrarily nested application conditions. And in our paper, we first focus on the case that also the matches for the rules stem from the given class of monomorphisms M. But I will mainly try to illustrate what we are doing and won't go too much into the technical details. And if you're not familiar with this kind of category theory, you can just think of graphs and injective homomorphisms in the rest of the talk. Okay, quick reminder, concurrent rule construction. The first line shows two rules, and the concurrent rule construction hinges on such an graph or object E, which encodes how the right-hand side of the first rule overlaps with the left-hand side of the second rule, and then we apply to E the first rule in an inverse way and the second rule forward, and we obtain the interface of the concurrent rule by intersecting these objects C1 and C2, and this leads to filtering out the transient elements. And then there's the famous concurrency theorem for this construction, which says that we have a rule synthesis. So if we have an irrelated transformation sequence, there exists a direct transformation via a concurrent rule. And in the other direction, if we have a direct transformation via a concurrent rule, we can instead apply the two underlying rules in a sequence, and those two things are inverse to each other up to isomorphism. Now we want to add to this construction being able to identifying elements which the first rule deletes with elements which the second rule creates, and we need some kind of object which allows us to do this, and that's what we call common kernel for two rules. Common kernel is basically an M morphism. He called K cap and morphism an object V, and this object V identifies elements from L1. V is embedded to L1 and R2 also via M morphisms in this work. Squares should constitute pullbacks. Now, if we already have given a concurrent rule, these morphisms E1 and E2, they encode how R1 and L2 overlap, and this K cap from the common kernel embeds into K1 and K2, so it also encodes how K1 and K2 overlap, and those both kinds of identification should coincide. So our common kernels, this embedding of K cap to K1 and K2 needs to fit to the chosen object E and morphisms E1 and E2, and that's just expressed by saying this square 2 is also a pullback. Okay, an example for a common kernel. This is again for the two rules from the example for the beginning. So here is the rule remove middleman. Here is extract subclass, and we want to be able to identify the class 2 with the class 6, and as well for the incoming references. So we have an object V, which contains the graph K1 and K2, and extends this with the class and incoming reference, and this is embedded in L1 and R2. And the central square is a pullback, so this common kernel is compatible with the choice of E for the concurrent rule from the example. That's already all we need for the construction of a generalized concurrent rule. This diagram contains the definition. So everything in blue is the classical concurrent rule. The dotted red line highlights the common kernel, which embeds into the left morphism of the first rule and into the right morphism of the second rule. And the universal property of K as pullback object says there is a morphism P from K cap to K. And so we can compute the new interface of the generalized concurrent rule by just joining the interface of a concurrent rule with these objects V, which identify elements from L1 and R2. And so we compute K prime as pushout of K and V along K cap. And the universal property of that pushout then guarantees the existence of a morphism L prime from K prime to L, the left hand side of the concurrent rule, and as well a morphism R prime to the right-hand side of the concurrent rule. So our generalized concurrent rule is this newly computed interface K prime with these two unique morphisms such that everything commutes. And if the underlying rules already came with application conditions, a generalized concurrent rule is just equipped with the application condition of the underlying concurrent rule. So we compute application conditions for generalized concurrent rules exactly in the same way as for concurrent rules. example for a computation of a generalized concurrent rule. It's again the example from the beginning, and I only show the computation of the interface and how it embeds into the left-hand side of the concurrent rule. So we have the rule remove middleman, we have kcap, which contains the two classes, we have v, which additionally contains the class 2 and its incoming reference, and as a result, we just additionally put this reference and the class 2.6 into the interface of the concurrent rule and obtain the suitable morphism into the left-hand side of the concurrent rule. Okay, some results about this construction. In our paper, we discuss how this relates to known constructions of rules. So it's well known that at least if we do not consider application conditions, concurrent rules and amalgamated rules generalize the parallel rule construction, and shortcut rules is a special kind of rule composition which we suggested at GCM 2018. And now in our paper, we show that the generalized concurrent rule construction generalizes the construction of concurrent rules. So every concurrent rule is a generalized concurrent rule for the common kernel just being an isomorphism. And every shortcut rule is a generalized concurrent rule. Basically, we introduced shortcut rules only for monotonic rules. And the generalized concurrent rule construction can now be seen as a way to introduce this shortcut rules and arbitrary application conditions. We also prove that the construction results in a always in a linear rule. So L prime and R prime are M morphisms again. And here we need M effective unions for this result to hold. And maybe you observed this in the diagram of the construction. A generalized concurrent rule is just a rule that extends the interface of an underlying concurrent rule. So this is, if the top row is a concurrent rule, a generalized concurrent rule for this rule will always be just a rule with a larger interface. So there is a morphism K prime that connects the interfaces such that both triangles commute. Now the question arises, if that's the case, what kind of larger interfaces can I capture? So if I have a concurrent rule and I have a rule with a larger interface K prime, such that it still that there are still suitable morphisms to L and R, is this a generalized concurrent rule? And we answer this question based on initial pushouts. So initial pushouts are a generalization of complements. And we prove that such an extended interface car prime of a concurrent rule belongs to a generalized concurrent rule if and only if the initial pushout over K prime, so this captures which elements are in K prime, which are not present in K, so the newly added elements, if these factorize compatibly, so there need to be some commutative diagrams, some diagrams which have to be commutative. Okay, this K, the initial pushout over K prime factors compatibly through the initial pushout over L1, so the left morphism of the first rule, and R2, the right morphism of the second rule. So the difference between K prime and K needs to stem from the elements which the first rule deletes and the second rule creates. So this is a consistency check for our construction. We do not arbitrarily enlarge this interface, but we really have formalized this kind of directed preservation elements, which the first rule deletes. And the second rule creates can be put into this larger interface, but nothing else. And we think that this can also serve as basis for an efficient implementation. So we need not search for common kernels, but we can directly take a concurrent rule and see if it's possible to identify some deleted elements with created elements, such that the deleted stem from the first rule and the created ones from the second. And this should be way more efficient than to implement the definition directly, but we have not implemented it yet. Okay, now let's come to the generalized concurrency theorem. At the very beginning, I showed this example and I said, okay, we want to have generalized concurrent rules because here's a situation where we would like to have something that behaves like the concurrent rule, but which is applicable more often. And I also showed you reminded you of the concurrency theorem. And basically, this means we can apply the generalized concurrent rule more often than the concurrent rule, which means every application of the concurrent rule can be split up into applications of the two underlying rules, and vice versa, application of the two underlying rules can be synthesized into an application of the concurrent rule. We can apply the generalized concurrent rule more often, so there will not always be the possibility to split up the application of a generalized concurrent rule into an application of the two underlying rules. And this example shows one example of this. I can apply the generalized concurrent rule, match the first class to client, the second to employee, the third to person, but I cannot apply the rule remove middleman because it would need to delete the employee class, and that's not possible because of this outgoing reference edge to company. But synthesis is always possible. So each E-related transformation sequence of two rules can equivalently be replaced by a transformation that applies a generalized concurrent rule. And if we have a direct transformation via a generalized concurrent rule, there exists such an E-related transformation sequence which applies the first rule and then the second obtains the same results with the induced match for the first rule, if and only if the first rule is applicable at this match. So basically in the setting of graphs and injective matching, this means that the only hindrance to split up an application of the generalized concurrent rule in the application of two of its two underlying rules is exactly this dangling edge. If this would mean to apply the first rule in such a way that it would leave an edge dangling. Future work. We would like to generalize from M to arbitrary matching, and we basically already did this, but not yet in this ICGT paper. It would be interesting to extend this theory for approaches that allow for deletion in unknown context. So basically, you can copy the very same construction, and it still makes sense for single or sesqui pushout rewriting. But in single or sesqui pushout rewriting, there might be additional implicit deletion. And of course, it would be interesting to extend the construction that such that also implicitly deleted elements could be preserved. And this would mean to do additional and new work. There are quite a lot of general concurrent rules for a single concurrent rule. So it would be interesting to come up with some kind of classification, which kind of extensions of the interface, which kind of common kernels are interesting for which kind of classifications. And we would be interested in implementing this computation in our tool Henshin. So in the last minutes, I showed you our construction of generalized concurrent rules as concurrent rules with extended interfaces that allow for a kind of directed preservation. So this extension respects the flow of information. Only elements deleted by the first rule can be identified as recreated by the second rule and then be preserved in the generalized concurrent rule in contrast to the concurrent rule. The construction generalizes the one-cut rules and we obtain a generalized concurrency theorem for our setting. So thank you very much for your attention and I'm happy to answer questions.